Once Xin Tu broke my chakraless mob switch. In particular, when a villager turns into a zombie, he doesn't pop off of a minecart anymore. And while the rest of the system works fine, let's take this as an opportunity to make a better overall system that will work in all 1.16 subversions and hopefully in the future as well. As usual, if there is an update on this topic or something has been broken, I'll pin a message in comments and maybe I'll make a video. A quick theory recap. Do not skip it, it is important. Minecraft has a mob limit. For hostile mobs, it is 70 per concurrently online player plus 1 mob. If you would have those mobs somewhere in the loaded chunks, no new mobs would be able to spawn in the entire dimension. Imagine playing without hostile mobs unless you need them, and having all the benefits of the hard difficulty. However, if you would rename a regular hostile mob or give him an item, that mob would be taken off from the mob cap, so this won't work. What will work though is trading with a villager and converting him into a zombie. This zombie now will not despawn, but will count towards the mob cap. Now we need 71 of them. Trading with a villager is necessary, by the way, otherwise a zombie villager will despawn. To make a mob switch, we'll take advantage of the spawn chunks. It is a 19 by 19 area of chunks around the world spawn in the overworld, which is always loaded as long as there are players on the server. Around that area, we have one layer of lazy chunks and one layer of even lazier chunks, 23 by 23 in total. If we would place our 70 zombie villagers per player plus one somewhere within these two rings of chunks, they will be always loaded, they will count towards the mob cap, but because these are lazy chunks, zombie villagers will not be processed, which means their performance impact will be negligible. Even with like 700 mobs, that's how many you need to support 10 players. Mob limits are handled separately in each dimension, which means if you would have a mob switch only in the overworld and you would go to the nether, you will encounter hostile mobs there. We will talk about the nether switch as well. Note, spectator players do raise the mob cap. If you want to log in with your camera account, you need to account for 2 concurrently online players, which is 141 mobs. However, if you would have the game rule spectators generate chunks set to false, spectators wouldn't raise the mob cap. Does this work on Spigot or Paper Spigot? I have no idea. Spigot breaks so many things on so many levels, it is impossible to tell if something is going to work or not. It is even worse, in fact. It depends on a particular server and its set of plugins and configs, not just on Spigot itself. I would strongly recommend to not play on Spigot. I have a whole video explaining why. Play on Fabric. That one is faithful to vanilla mechanics. Today I'm going to show you 2 designs for the overworld and 1 for the nether. Unfortunately, there is no feasible way to make a mob switch for the end dimension. This is my main design. Let's take a look at it in action. We have a villager breeder that produces baby villagers. They are gathered here until they grow up. When they grow up, they glitch through that red glass block and end up in the storage chamber. When we press this button, a minecart picks up a villager and moves it next to a workstation. Here we trade with the villager to make his zombie self non-despawnable, and then we press this button to send him into the zombification chamber. Zombificator has a renamed zombie with a sharpness 5 axe that converts a villager into a zombie villager. And that zombie villager gets moved into the holding cell. Each of those cells can store only 24 villagers because of the cramming limit. So you need 3 cells per player to store 72 mobs, which is just slightly above the mob cap per player. The second overworld design and my old 1.16 design have a single anti-cramming chamber instead, but this option has a significant problem I'm going to talk about later. Because we are making a mob switch, it needs to be toggleable, right? Check this out. When we press a button, zombie villagers get moved from one side of a cell to the other, and if we place these cells in between the second ring of laser chunks and the outside chunks, we can toggle the mob switch on and off. If they're here, then they will be loaded by the spawn chunks, which will prevent hostile mobs from spawning in the overworld. And if they are there, then they are outside of the spawn chunks and will not be loaded unless there's a player nearby. And thanks to the carpet mod and its lock mob caps command, we can absorb the mob cap numbers on the tab screen. Let's start building it, shall we? First, we need to find the edge of the outer spawn chunks, and we start from the world spawn. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. And across the 12th and the 13th chunks, we build the storage cells. Or you can use mini HUD mod to display the spawn chunks. The side of this giant red box is the plane that should divide the storage cells. Now we need to build a single storage module, and the reason why we build the mob switch backwards on the end is because the positioning of this specific part is very important and everything else is going to be relative to it. So we have the symmetrical build, but on this side we have 4 dispensers with a water bucket inside each, and on the opposite side we have 4 water sources and an empty bucket inside each dispenser. We have 7 solid blocks here, 9 block spaces in total. We have 3 block deep holes with soul sand on the bottom here, and there are 2 blocks between the floor and the ceiling. When we send a signal, water sources get switched and zombie villagers get moved from one pit to the other. In the middle, we have an open trapdoor surrounded by blocks. This is for the transportation system. By the way, zombie villagers cannot turn into drowns. Next, we need to stack a couple of modules together and put repeaters before the cross junctions. And as I've said, you need 3 modules per player, and if you have done everything correctly, you should have 3 blocks between the ceilings of the modules. And if you want to build a huge amount of modules, consider starting from the corner so that you have enough space. This is going to be in the world unknowns, by the way. Let's test that we have wired our modules correctly. Very fine. Next, we build the transportation system. For each trapdoor from the modules, we place open fence gates here and here, and a water source here. This will make a conveyor belt for zombie villagers. A zombie villager will drop down into the first open trapdoor available. It means once you have 24 zombie villagers in place, you need to close a trapdoor manually. You need the fence gate setup for every single module. I was trying to make it every 2 modules, but in that case, zombies had enough momentum to skip a cell. A huge note here and a potential point of failure. If you'll send more than 24 zombies into the same cell, then one of them will die due to the cramming limit, drop rotten flesh, and another zombie will pick that rotten flesh, which will take him out of the mob cap, but keep him despawnable. So now this chamber can block only 23 mobs from spawning. If we would drop another zombie, then someone else will die again, and yet another zombie will pick its drops instead, leaving us with 22 maximum slots being blocked by this cell. We will get to the optional system that will alert you when it is time to seal a chamber. Alright, the storage part is over, now we need to make the zombification chamber. We start with the tube going upward, and a sticky piston with a block in front of it placed on top of the ceiling of the first module. If we power this piston, a block should block the tube. Next, we make a hopper clock with 10 items inside, and an additional block here with redstone dust on top. And a torch. It is important that since 1.16, these 2 redstone crosses have to be crosses. Otherwise, a hopper clock will not work. And next, we have a zombie with a sharpness 5 axe. Here we have a trapdoor within the same block space that keeps a zombie in place. Notice that the block from this side has to be transparent, because otherwise the hopper clock would power a trapdoor and open it. The idea here is that when a villager falls down, this hopper clock gets started, this red block gets extended, and after a zombie will convert a villager, the red block will be retracted and a zombie villager will fall down. Note, you want to play on the hard difficulty while using this contraption, because on other difficulties, villagers have a chance to not create a zombie villager and just die instead. This is the alarm counter. When it goes off, it means you have 24 villagers in one storage cell, and you need to seal it off by flicking this lever and closing the trapdoor. You put 24 items inside a dropper, and each time a villager goes into the zombificator, this dropper gets fired and sends an item into a hopper. This hopper is locked by this redstone torch, which will get depowered once the amount of items in a dropper reaches zero. This comparator turns off. These comparators will turn on and extend the signal for just enough time to get all 24 items back into a dropper. Hopefully, this will help you to not miss the alarm. Next, we need a storage chamber for living villagers, a minecart truck, and a trading station. You want them to go outside of the spawn chunks because there is no need for them being lazily loaded. We order a villager by pressing this button, which activates a power trail. Then that villager gets next to the workstation, we trade with him, and we press this button to send him to the zombificator. A minecart goes over this activator rail, it ejects a villager onto this red block, and then a minecart goes through a detector rail that depowers a piston and a villager falls down. The type of workstation you use depends on which resources you have the most, but to trade with cartographers you need only paper or emeralds. And this is a good moment to mention that it is going to be a very slow and tedious process to wait for villagers to breed and then to trade with each of them one by one. It is bearable to make 71 zombie villagers to fill a mob hub for a single person, but 701 for 10? You know, in that case maybe you want to consider a mob switch powered by withers. These blocks here prevent a villager from being ejected onto rails, and thus, the only place he can go is this red block. Also, the same detector rail that retracts this piston is responsible for starting the hopper clock and counting the alarm counter. There is a small chance that a zombie will think way too long and not have enough time to convert a villager, but even then, he will probably have a nice company at the storage cell. From my tests, the track setup is not directional thanks to these two rails slope, but just in case, north is in that direction. Let's take a look at the villager storage chamber. In my previous design, it was 3x3, but villagers have started to cram way too soon for my likings, so 5x5 it is. We have one water source, which is here, in that far corner, one block above the floor. And the chamber is 3 blocks high. In most contraptions, you can replace glass with solid blocks, but here, I would recommend using glass where you see glass. It also helps with mob-proofing the area. And the final component is a villager breeder. We have 3 options here. Gnebombs, invisible spiders, and impulses viz. However, impulses design is reported to randomly break, so I would recommend to stick to the other two. Gnebombs design is faster, but it also utilizes more parent villagers and an external source of food. Psst, hey, do you want a teaser for my next video? Here we go. The food system in Minecraft is... You might be wondering, why do we bother with bulky storage cells when we can have just one that uses vines to bypass the grinding limit? We had that in the previous design, right? The issue is that you cannot move mobs from the anti-grinding chamber, which means you need to have it outside of the spawn chunks and use chunk loaders in order to load that area to make the mob switch toggleable. However, chunk loaders aren't instant, which means every single time you load a single player world or restart a server, there is a time window when the mob switch is not active, even if it should have been. With the DS design, this problem isn't present anymore, because if the mob switch is turned on, mobs get loaded with the spawn chunks, which means immediately. So, my second overall design is basically the design from my previous video, but with a fix to the minecart problem. Watch that video for the full explanation if you want to build one, but as I've said, while this design is easier to build, it has that major downside of mobs spawning after you load the world. But what if you want to make a mob switch for the Nether to stop those pesky pig people from spawning? Two problems we face in the Nether is that there are no spawn chunks and no water. What we need to do is to create zombie villagers in the overworld, teleport them to the Nether, store them somewhere, and keep that somewhere loaded by a chunk loader. Oh yeah, chunk loaders. So much fun. I have a full video dedicated to chunk loading, but in short, when something, including items, goes through a portal, it loads an area around the exit portal for 15 seconds. In the overworld, we have a contraption on a timer that sends an item through a portal, and a portal on the other side sends that item back. In that video, I said that a portal loads a 5x5 chunk area, but apparently, mobs count towards the mob cap within a 7x7 chunk area around the portal. So, we take the overworld design and replace a zombie village chamber with a nether portal. On the other side of a portal, we have an anti-crime chamber and two turtle eggs to lure a zombie villager into it. Mobs will consider an open trapdoor as a walkable block, and thus, they will have no problems walking off the edge of a portal. And this trapdoor will ensure that a zombie villager has no chance on standing on that trapdoor and escaping the chamber. Also, we can ignore occasional zombie piglins, they will eventually despawn anyway. But the Nether mob switch isn't without its drawbacks. The spawn chunks representation in the Nether is very, very small, and you need to have an active chunk loader within this specific area to be constantly loaded, and you need to have an anti-crime chamber within this or these rings of chunks to avoid them being processed 100% of the time, and on the other side of this portal, we build the rest of the contraption. Which means, when you go to the Nether, you are very, very likely to fully load the entities in a mob switch by a player. But if you think of it, without a mob switch, you would just spawn those 70 hostile mobs anyway. Whew. That was a lengthy video, and I hope it explained the mob switch very well. World downloads, links to villager breeders, and other stuff will be in the description. Bye-bye.